Hadid tells us Allah prays. Abu Umama reported the messenger of Allah said, Allah and his messengers and the people of the heavens and the earth, even the ants on their rocks and fish, pray for blessing on those who teach people good. Question simple, who is the he of the prayer?
There is something called relational verbs. I know English is not your first language. I know you haven't studied languages. But to be clear here, when we speak about God, the meaning of words change. So for example, when Christians say that God died, you say it cannot apply to the divine nature. It's a relational verb.
What he just said, for anyone who knows basic grammar, was complete, utter, total nonsense. Any English teacher would be giggling himself or herself out of his chair right now to hear what Ijaz just said. Here's what a relational verb is, right? So this is a cup, right? And I say, this cup contains water. Contains is a relational verb. It's not that the cup is performing some action. It's that the relationship between the cup and the water is that one contains the other. It's a relational verb. It shows the relationship between the two. This cup costs, let's say, $10. Costs there is a relational verb, right? It's meant to connect two things and to show the relationship. You don't just say the cup costs, right? Because it's not some action that the cup is performing. You don't say the cup costs. Say the cup costs $10. The word costs there shows you the relationship between the cup and the $10. So that's what relational verbs are. They show a relationship between two things. Now, why is that a problem for what he just said? Well, after he completely destroyed the meaning of what relational verbs are, he thinks that, you know, a relational verb, well, what he actually claimed is that a relational verb is a verb that changes its meaning depending on, you know, what it's doing. Yeah. But then he goes on to say that die is a relational verb. And he says that pray is a relational verb, and therefore that these words change their meanings. Now, what's the problem here? Well, die and pray aren't relational verbs, right? They're not showing it. As a general rule, if you can just use the word and say I die or I am dying, well, it's not a relational verb. You don't need that, right? You don't need the noun to show the relationship. You can say I pray. What are you doing? I'm praying. Well, that means it's not a relational verb. I'm dying. It's not a relational verb, right? Again, relational verbs are showing the relationship between two things. So Ijaz, his entire defense was, but relational verbs change their meaning. No, relational verbs show the relationship between two things. That was one. So false. His second was, dies in the Christian context is a relational verb. No, it's not. And he also says
that when it comes to the word Salah in the Quran, when it applies to God, it means something else. It's a relational verb.
All you need to do is say, no, here's what the word means, and here's how we can show and prove that this is what the word means, right? The problem is when we go to you Muslims and we say, what does the word mean? What does Salah mean? If we don't tell you it's about Allah, you always say it means prayer, right? You always say that. Every last one of you say prayer. It means prayer. But when we say Allah does it, and then we say, okay, if it doesn't mean prayer, what does it mean? You just give us like 10 different definitions, and you can't defend any one of them. And every last one of them is refuted by your own Muslim sources. And so that's why we don't take it seriously. So if Ijaz wants us to take it seriously, he's going to just have to give us the translation and show that it's true. Sam, what's the problem with Ijaz's definition there?
Yeah, in fact, I want people to notice, and again, we're trusting the Holy Spirit of the living God to guide our conversation, to speak truth without error for the glory of Jesus Christ, because I don't want to be mistaken, even when I represent Islam. I don't know if you guys caught it. He first said the prayer is blessing, then he said rahmah.
So in the Quran, what it says is that Allah gives his blessings, his rahmah, upon the Prophet, peace be upon him. That's simply what it means.
Well, blessing and rahmah don't mean the same thing. Blessing in Arabic is barakah, rahmah means mercy. Number one, I'm going to now show you a verse from the Quran itself where rahmah is distinguished from prayer. salawat. Here it is, chapter 2, verse 157. Upon them rest the prayers and mercy from their Lord. Prayers and mercy. Salawat, and then it's rahma. Two different words that don't mean the same thing. Salawatun min rabbihim wa rahmatun. So here it's salawat and rahma showing they don't mean the same thing. Mm-hmm. Second problem. If you guys remember in our previous shows, we actually went in depth in demonstrating that the Muslim scholars themselves admit that Muhammad, Ijaz's prophet. Now, don't tell me that Muhammad, his prophet, got it wrong. Muhammad, Ijaz's prophet, distinguished between the word Salah and the word for blessing, Baraka. The word blessing in Arabic is Baraka. And that when Muhammad taught his followers to say the prayer upon him, because again, any Muslim will confirm this, their prayers are incomplete if they don't pray for Muhammad. In other words, when Muslims pray five times a day, in order for their prayers to be efficacious, acceptable to Allah, they must pray for Muhammad. Now, when Muhammad is asked, how do we pray for you when we're praying to Allah? Here, let me read it. This comes from Ibn Kathir's exposition of chapter 33, verse 56. This is not me. Ibn Kathir, which you can read online in an abridged English translation for yourself. Folks, pay attention. Muhammad himself separates the word blessing from prayer, barakah from salah. Now watch. I'm going to pick it up in mid-sentence. Al-Bukhari recorded that Ka'b bin Ujrah said, it was said, O Messenger of Allah, with regard to sending salam, salam means peace, upon you. When we send peace upon you, we know about this. We know how to send peace upon you. But how about salah? He said, say, guys, pay attention. Say, O Allah, send your salah upon Muhammad and upon the family of Muhammad, as you sent your salah upon the family of Ibrahim. Verily, you are the most praiseworthy, most glorious. Now watch, folks. O Allah, send your blessings upon Muhammad and upon the family of Muhammad, as you sent your blessings upon the family of Ibrahim. Verily, you are most praiseworthy. And again, here's another one. Say, O Allah, send your salah. And interestingly, salah is not translated, it's transliterated, because this is a Salafi translation of Ibn Kathir. So in this Salafi translation, they chose to transliterate salah, not translate it. I wonder why, David. But when it comes for the word blessing, they translate it as blessing. O Allah, send your salah upon Muhammad and upon the family of Muhammad, as you sent your salah upon the family of Ibrahim. Verily, you are the most praiseworthy, most glorious. O Allah, send your blessings upon Muhammad and upon the family of Muhammad, as you sent your blessings upon the family of Ibrahim. So the first line of evidence that salah, and I'm talking about Allah's salah, not talking about the angel salah or the believer salah, because it's not about Allah sending his salah. Here, Muhammad distinguishes the salah of Allah, the prayer of Allah, from the blessing of Allah. That's number one. Number two, this comes from Qadi Iyad in his monumental work called Ash-Shifa. You remember in the previous sessions, I said that this work was recommended by Hamza Yusuf. That's how I found out about it. Many people don't know that I actually enjoy listening to Hamza Yusuf. He's actually my favorite Muslim scholar, more so than Yasser Qadi, because I know others like Yasser Qadi. So I listen to hours of his lectures so I can see what I can learn from him to use against Islam for the glory of Jesus Christ. That's why I listen to them. In one of his lectures, he said, every Muslim must have this on their shelf. Qadi Iyad Musa al-Yasubi al-Shifa, which is translated by Aisha Abdurrahman Buley. Now, let me read to you what this renowned Muslim source states about prayer and blessing. It is said, this comes from page 25. Folks, this is not me. This is not David. These are not Jews. These are Muslims who love Allah and His Messenger more than anything. Page 25, it is said that they pray means they invoke blessing. That's what Ijaz just said, right, David?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Ijaz said Allah's prayer means blessing. It is said that they pray means they invoke blessing, barakah. However, when the Prophet taught people the prayer on himself, which I just read from Ibn Kathir, he made a distinction between the words salat, prayer, and barakah. Did you catch it? Qadi Iyad notes that Muhammad himself, when he taught people to pray on him, he distinguished prayer from blessing. In other words, it cannot have the same meaning. Now again, the same source, page 250. The Prophet made a distinction between prayer and blessing, salat and barakah, in the hadith in which he taught about making the prayer on him. This indicates they have two separate meanings. Let me repeat it again. This indicates that they have two separate meanings. This is Ali. Don't tell me Ali doesn't know Arabic. Ali used to teach us the prayer on the Prophet as follows. O Allah, the one who spread out the flat expanses and created the heavens. Watch this, folks. Bestow, and now Aisha Bewley translates the verb, your noble prayers. David, did you catch it? Mm-hmm. Aisha Bewley, who translated this work, translated the verb as your noble prayers, bestow your noble prayers, increasing blessing and the compassion of your tenderness upon Muhammad. So he distinguished between the verb for prayer, the verb for blessing, the verb for compassion, and even Aisha Bewley did not translate the word for prayer as blessing or mercy, but as noble prayers of Allah. Your noble prayers of Allah, along with your blessing, along with your compassion of your tenderness. And then finally, page 258, Ibn Mas'ud. Now you and I, David, know why Ibn Mas'ud is important. Because Muhammad said, when you want to learn the Quran, you learn it from four people. And he started with this man, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Right? Now notice what Ibn Mas'ud said. Ibn Mas'ud, this comes from page 258 of Bewley's translation of Qadiyat. And it's all in our articles. Ibn Mas'ud used to say, when you bless the Prophet, then make the prayer on him excellent. You do not know. Perhaps it will be shown to him. Watch. And by the way, that's interesting. We need to go into discussion. What does it mean for Muhammad to be able to see the prayers of his followers? You don't know. It may be shown to him. We'll talk about deification of Muhammad. Say, this is Ibn Mas'ud, David. O Allah, bestow your prayers, your mercy, and your blessing on the master of the messengers. Wait. Bestow your prayers, your mercy, and blessing? Hold on. I thought Allah's prayers was his mercy or his blessings. Why did Ibn Mas'ud distinguish between the three words here? Allah, your prayers, your mercy, your blessing, bestow on Muhammad. If they meant the same thing, why use these three different words separately?
And notice the kind of help that Allah needs, right?
Yeah.
Allah needs multiple Muslim apologists to come along and just keep lying over and over again to try and explain away what he said, right? That's the help Allah needs. He doesn't just need someone to come along and say, oh, well, here's how we know that in this particular verse, it means something completely different from what it normally means. And here's our evidence for that. He needs his apologists to come along and just start making stuff up left and right.
Yeah,
launch personal attacks, speak in the most arrogant and condescending manner imaginable, so that the Muslims who are surrounding and watching will think that a powerful answer has been given. And you just wonder, wow, you know, Allah couldn't say what he meant, but nor could he send any apologist to give any sort of reasonable defense of what he actually meant. So, Sam, they're making me feel kind of bad for Allah here, right?
You're right.
I mean, Allah's trying, right? He's trying to say what he means. He just can't get the words out right. He just can't do it. He can't get the right words out. So he needs a little help from his apologist, but he can't send someone who can speak truthfully and explain it. He can only send someone who makes a bunch of stuff up. And those are the only people Allah can send. This is like the God of incompetence here.
Don't forget the point of 3356. 3356 was composed to exhort Muslims and encourage them to pray for Muhammad. Why? This is what the passage is basically saying, because we've gotten so much into proving that Allah prays that we're forgetting the import of the passage. Folks, remember why 3356 was composed. It's basically telling Muslims, you Muslims, you need to pray for Muhammad. Why? Allah and his angels pray for him. If Allah and his angels are praying for him, how much more should you be praying for him? That's the context. The context is telling Muslims, you need to be praying for your prophet. If Allah himself is praying for him and angels are praying for him, don't you think you should be praying for him?